All right, I've got a fresh scene opened up here, a fresh project in Animation Master. I will import the sound first off, which is going to be the Nightmare Wave clip on the CD in the audio folder. I'm going to open up our Insect Man head, which is what we'll be using for this little lovely bit of animation. You don't need the model window open. What I'll do is start a new action, which is automatically going to use him because he's the only one we've got in the loaded up so far. I've rearranged the screen a little bit to make this a little easier, so we can put the graph down here, have the pose sliders up here, and still have access to the project workspace items that we may or may not need to get it to. You never know. Now that we've got him loaded up, we're going to start syncing this guy, but before we even do that, before we even set a single key, we're going to break down the audio just a little bit. And because this clip is in Italian, I've got a transcript that I've put on the CD, actually for both clips, in a transcript text file. And just so you can see what that is, I'll pull this up really briefly here. So, we've got this clip from A Nightmare Before Christmas in Italian. Jump back over here and play it, so you can read along.
Tu vuoi che io muoia di fame? Sono un vecchietto che a stento si regge sulle sue deboli forze. Io, a cui tu devi la tua stessa vita.
All right, the English translation down here says, you want me to starve? An old man like me who hardly has any strength as it is. Me, to whom you owe your very life. As you're listening to the Italian version of that, you can hear he's basically trying to put the pressure on whoever his captor is. I haven't seen the film in a while, so I'm totally spacing on what's going on in the scene. But he's trying to put the pressure on it and get this guy to let him go. And the way he's doing that is through a little bit of intimidation and even a bit of a guilt trip. He starts off kind of low-key and says, you want me to starve? Now, if somebody said that to you, you want me to starve? There's a basic human emotion going on there. We don't, you know, as far as murder and death and that kind of thing goes. So that's kind of touching on the base side of that thing. You know, do you want me to starve? Do you want me to die? Are you so base in your appreciation for human life that you don't even care if I die? That's kind of the underlying current for this thing. But then he puts the pressure on a little bit more and says, an old man like me who hardly has any strength as it is. Now he's trying to pull on any feelings that he might have for the older generation. You know, an old man. So that puts an additional level of pressure on the person he's talking to. And then he really kicks it in and says, me, to whom you owe your very life. Basically, without me, you would not live, and yet you want me to die. What is wrong with you? And so he's trying to convince this guy to let him go by, you know, appealing to him at these various emotional levels of just human life. So we can try and get a little bit of that into the lip sync here. It's not going to be a whole ton. Again, most of the stuff, if we were doing a full animation on this, it would happen in the body postures and the rest of the facial features. We're only going to do the lip sync in this particular segment. But we can still get a little bit of that tension, a little bit of that emotion that we need in the way the lip shapes are formed. It's going to be kind of tame starting off during this first line, tu vuoi che io muoia di fame. And as it goes along, it's going to build ever so slightly. We'll play the clip again. You can hear it. It's a really subtle build in the vocal delivery, but it's there.
Tu vuoi che io muoia di fame? Sono un vecchietto che a stento si regge sulle sue deboli forze. Io, a cui tu devi la tua stessa vita.
Part of where you hear that really hit is in this part here, io. This is the io's, or from what I guess anyway, the Italian interpretation for me. And he's really putting the pressure on that final me, to whom you owe your very life. So that's going to be kind of the peak of the whole thing. And then, again, he's just kind of continuing that on through the remainder of this line. So we're going to use that as our basis for starting off and doing the lip sync on this character. So first off, I dragged this open here so we've got all the proper blending going on between the fan bones and the rig, especially for his mouth. And then we'll go into the mouth. We're going to be working mostly in the main controls. What I think I want to do, we'll start off by just setting a default pose for him to start off this thing. We'll get into some moving holds later on as he'll ease into his first little bit of speech. But to start off, we'll just open the mouth a little bit here. Pull the upper lip and lower lip away just a touch, even a little bit less than that. And then I'm going to go down into the fine controls and pull the corners down just a little bit. You know, he's not too neutral. He's getting upset at this guy. So that's a little too far. I think right around there is going to be good. Again, a little discrepancy is just fine. A little organic flavor to this thing. So this will be our first pose, our starting point here. He's going to kind of get, you know, build into this first line as he goes in here. So getting into this T at the beginning of this piece here, and I'm gonna pull my other thing down out of the way so I can see what's going on. You may wanna have a copy of this up, even though, again, we're not really focusing too much on the words, it helps to know what sounds are being made. And some of the sounds in this thing are a little misleading if you're just listening to the audio alone. So that's why it's good to have a transcript of the dialogue handy while you're doing this kind of work. So as he's going into the T at the very beginning of this, two, we're gonna do a little bit of a moving hold, but we'll get into that later. Right now, we're just gonna kind of block out some basic poses for this guy, do pretty rough work on this. It's gonna be adding a lot of detail here and there in some respects, but overall, it's gonna be a basic first pass. I'll probably do the first line, just the tu vuoi che io muoia di fame. I'll do that part initially, and then we'll go back and maybe do some polish on that, and then get into some of the stuff later on. Getting into that first line, what I want to do, I want to see all of my user properties down here so we can see what's going on. And generally what I like to do, probably should do this before I get too much farther, since this is going to be my starting pose, I want to kind of lock everything in, at least set a key on all of these various sliders as we go along here. So I'm just going to do that, and probably should have done these on zeros to start off with, just to make it a little easier. Those have already been set. And the rest of these are just 0, 0, 0, 0. You can tab through them. And there's the last one. So we've got keys on all those various channels set. We've got the little dots here on the timeline. I'm not going to be looking at the graph too much just yet. I just want to see where the various sliders are being keyed. I'm going to go ahead and leave this on spline interpolation for now. We'll go and again adjust interpolation and start messing with things in the graph editor a little bit later on. So we've got our starting point here. So the T starts to hit right around in there. We're going to need to anticipate that a little bit by opening the mouth or preparing and getting some additional shapes to get into that T. So probably what I typically do when I'm doing poses for these things is just to lock everything in. I just do Control-C, Control-V, a simple copy-paste, and that's an easy way to set keys on everything using their current values at whatever frame I happen to be at. So I'll leave that there. I'll leave this where I can see the time or the wave graph. So we'll start getting into that T right in here. And because he's going into an oo sound, too, I'm going to start to pull the lips together in a little bit of a purse as he's doing that T. We'll do all kinds of overlap and things later on, but again, this is just very rough. So I'm going to close the jaw, pull this into a little bit of a pucker, and open the lips just a little bit farther. We'll start to add some attitude into this too, maybe even a little bit of a sneer. He's probably going to be sneering at various levels throughout the course of this thing, with it building again as it goes toward the end of the clip. Maybe a little bit more on the pucker there. Copy paste, lock everything in. What I typically try to do is key pretty much right on the sound. At the end of this thing, we'll slide everything back a couple frames, and that should provide the right offset, because typically when we're watching something happen in terms of video or film, we register the movement before we register the sound. And so it often helps to have the keys happen just a little bit before the sound is. But while we're keying it initially, we'll just lock everything in directly on the sound. And the T happens just after, it's right on this frame transition here. What I tend to do when I'm setting keys on this kind of stuff is set keys right on the peaks of where the sound is. So this ooh and the two. And he's actually kind of going into a little bit of a blend between ooh and oh. But we're not going to mess with that at this particular time. It's probably not going to be that visible when a character is speaking, that kind of thing. A lot of that's going to happen with the tongue inside the mouth. So that's not going to be too visible from the outside. So we'll open the jaw a little bit. We'll get this a little more into the ooh, a little farther. Actually, it might help to do that. So I'll open the jaw even a little bit more. We'll start to come out of that pucker, but not completely leaving it. The V starts, you hear the V start right around in here, right around that point there. So that's where I'll start keying that V shape, or puckering, or getting the bottom lip up on the teeth. So we'll close that, pull this up, pull the upper lip up even farther, and then we'll curl this lip in. Actually, I'll have to pull that open just a bit. What I think I'm going to do actually now is turn this to the side so I can get a better view of how this lip is behaving. We want to get that definitely curled in under the teeth. Again, it's not going to be super picky because I didn't do a super picky job with the shapes on this rig, but it gets the job done. It gets that kind of curling up underneath there. And that'll pretty much give us the basic impression that we want. And I might even go in, I'll probably work on some of this later. I'll leave the corners down where they are for now. I may do some adjustments later on to pull them back up so that it doesn't feel like they're locked in a position too much all the time, and to soften out this shape a little bit more. But just for now, to keep it consistent across the board, I'll leave them down where they're at. The next part of the sound here is voy, so he's going to be pursing the lips, puckering even a little bit more as he's coming out of this V. Actually, I think what I want to do, take this whole thing, slide this over a frame. Slide this over a frame. It sounds like it's coming in just a little farther from what I was. Now, getting into this V here, it's not going to be, it's, again, we're just on the default spline interpolation. It's going to be not linear, but kind of almost feeling like it's linear if it's just going straight from here to here with no adjustment to the interpolation in between. So, what we may want to do is listen really closely to how the voice transitions from the end of the tuo into the V for voy. And sometimes it helps to back up and just listen to the thing at full speed. It sounds like he's getting into that V pretty quick, so he's holding a little more on this vowel here, this O. So instead of letting this transition but kind of by default into this, we've got how many frames? 1, 2, 3, 4. So we can kind of put a little more, a little bias into this, you might say, and basically kind of shift the emphasis a little more towards this one. And the way to do that is to, what I do anyway, is put the time marker one frame past the key, copy that, then push it out one and paste it. So that takes, so the value that was here pushes it here, and therefore the curve is going to be leaning more towards this shape, and then the X accelerates a little bit more getting into this one. Now thankfully it doesn't go through this part too terribly quickly. The voy is pretty strong there, but it does hold on the V just a little bit. If you listen to it here. Got a little bit of hold on that V. So we're gonna to avoid. It's often hard to figure out how to do this right off the bat. This is the fun part of going through this stuff, is examining it and figuring out where stuff's supposed to happen. The O sounds like it's accenting right around in there, so we'll pull out of this. We'll uncurl the bottom lip. We'll pull this down just a bit, get rid of that. Open the jaw some. So he's getting into this voy kind of a thing. Copy paste. And again, because we want to hold that V, we want to hold that for at least two frames. So what I'll do, again, just to accent it more towards this, is I'll take this, copy this, back it up one here. Actually, it's the wrong way. And you take this one, copy that, paste it there. There we go. So it really punches into that voy pretty sharply there. Again, we'll do all kinds of finessing on this later on. Pretty rough at this point, letting the default interpolation kind of go as it is. And again, kind of like I was showing earlier on doing the M's and B's, P's and that kind of stuff, by pulling the lower lip up, you might end up doing that on this frame here. Take this lower lip up, pull it up as the jaw is starting to come down. Really put some emphasis on that V there. And actually what we could do, I'm just kind of curious. Actually, that works. That kind of gets what we're looking for. What I think I want to do is, because it's going into this O right in there, I want to pull that pucker in just a little bit more. You can watch how the slider's kind of going on its own over here. It's starting to kind of come up right around this. Actually, we might leave it as it is. We'll get into the finessing stage later on with that part of it. Listen to that again, see how that sounds. To avoid K, right in there. So he's going oi, so the E accent on that. Often what I'll do when I'm keying this stuff is find the extremes in some of the things and then come back into the middle and change some of the midpoints. But by getting the extremes off the bat, it makes it easier to get the midpoints so that they flow through this segment a little more naturally rather than trying to set a midpoint and then set the extreme, the flow might not be as smooth. So the void, we're gonna close the jaw, unpucker this thing here. And because he's coming out of this void, he's going into a k sound right in here to avoid k. But that's gonna be kind of a blend off of this, and he's going in an even wider E right in here to avoid K. So we may not even want to do, we'll leave the pucker right around there. We're not going to pull it all the way open. And getting into this shape down in here to avoid KE on this E right around this range, we'll probably take the wider slider, pull that up a little bit so we can really punch that E, that really sharp E that happens in there. Copy paste just for kicks. Because this is the midpoint of this, I don't want the jaw to go closed just yet. I actually want it to loop through this void. And that way it starts to get some of that nice curl in the corners of the mouth. And actually it blends right through this void. And you can kind of hear the mouth kind of, the tongue really anticipating and getting into that k, that k kind of a sound. Void k. It's starting to compress right in that range there. So what I'll probably do at that point, the k starts to decompress right around in here. You're hearing the breath come out. So actually what I'll probably do is take this, slide it over there. And because it's getting into this compression here before the k sound really unloads right there, it actually looks pretty good, I think. It's a good starting point because we're coming out of this really wide and closing the jaw, but we're letting it settle before this sound really kind of kicks in and starts to punch. So listen to it full speed again here. This kind of has a lot of blending going on right in here because he's coming out of the K and into another into the EO, another one of those me references. To avoid K, and again, blending into the M. That's going to be a fun little bit right in there. The K just kind of blends all into one. So that part there, we'll open the jaw a bit, and as it gets into the K, and we'll start to pull this wider. We'll release the pucker a little bit, get into this wider bit here. So that's the transition from the E into the E, to the K. So the E starts to transition right around there. So we'll do our last really strong E kind of a shape right around in there. We'll undo that, we'll pull the wider. And actually we might even try that smirk just a bit. I think I'm gonna pull his lips together. Although we may end up adding some sneer. Yeah, but a little flavor in there. We'll do some more of that kind of flavor later on, but anyway, that's as good as a starting point for this shape anyway, just to add a little extra something to it, so it doesn't look quite so flat, quite so blasé. Anyway, we're gonna just transition this right in here, not quite so default, because we're getting into that E, and the E lasts through a lot of this stretch right in here. So we're gonna, again, kind of lean the transition on this more towards the E. So we'll copy something from right around in there, let's say. We'll paste it back in this range. And that'll force that a little sooner, kind of. And there's a really strong transition coming out of that. This is gonna be an interesting little bit right through here. Let me slide that up, there we go. M. Again, I'm trying to find the extreme on this, where it comes out of this and transitions into the M, and then we'll start working with some of the in-between bits. Although, he holds that. Listen to how he's holding that. He holds it for a couple bits there, and then down into the M. And the M also almost sounds right at the end of this frame, you know, right in here. So there's a strong point. Although, we're not going to make it too strong because the accent sounds like it's closer on the next syllable right down in here. Ke ia moya, because he holds that mo really strong and really long there. So that one will get a little more emphasis. We won't pull this one quite so far, just enough. We'll pull that shut. Leave that right about there, I think. Lock everything in. A little farther open, I think. Actually, I don't want the wider coming on quite so strong right there. I want that to... There we go. A little better blend. So we'll put the M hitting right around in there. Close. Actually, I want to have the jaw a little bit open. We're going to do most of that M in this case with the lips. We'll take that sneer out. If I had a curl, if I had a control to take this lower lip and push it up and match that sneer, I would do it. And I may end up adding that in there in the rig sometime later on. Something to think about anyway. But for now, to get the lips together, we have to get rid of any kind of sneering or special curling we have on the upper lip. So we're going to pull these together. I might press them just a little bit. Just a touch there. I may even actually curl this one in just a little to really kind of punch that a little stronger. So he holds that. We've got our two frames easily in the way he's performing it here. So he comes out of the M into the O, into the Moya, right around in that range. Actually, I think I will pull this back a frame. Just, that'll give us a nice long hold on that M. Starting point here, I'll copy and paste it just to get things kind of set initially. And we've got a little, you know, default spline interpolation happening there. What I want to do, actually, just for starters, we'll key that in its current position. And for this one, we'll force the jaw open a little bit more because he's coming out of that M into the O. We'll force that open, but we'll, again, force the lips to stay together. Oh, that's the curl. And maybe even press him just a little bit more, right in there. He holds that more. It's a really kind of a slow, subtle blend into the oi, the E side of that oi. Moia di fame. And no, I can't speak Italian. I just say it how it sounds. So the O is going to start right in there. We'll pull this open a little farther. We'll have to unpress the lips. And speaking of unpressing the lips, we'll do that. We'll get rid of this smirk in here. Probably could have killed that a little while ago. We'll get this in a little more of an O. Moia di fame. And probably what we should have done is start to blend into that pucker a little bit more through here. So let's do that. And actually what I'm going to do, just so I can see what's going on, switch into graph mode here, take that key out, pull this up so we can get this blend happening right through here. There we go. Go back to connect the dots. Actually, I'm going to pull this jaw open quite a bit farther, I think, on this one. And purse it just a little more. And I think I'm going to bring some of that sneer back in just a touch. Right around there. Almost done with this initial segment here. This is going to be a tricky one to do because it's all vowel sounds. There's not a lot of clues happening in terms of how this transition happens. It's so soft. Although... So the E, moya, the transition to the E to the ya happens right around in here. So I'll probably find some way to get, this is going to be interesting, interesting. But we don't want this E that we're sculpting right around in here. I want that to be a little less pronounced than the E we're going to do right in here where he says moya di fame, the D. Get that a little stronger on this part. Try that. Yeah, I think I like how that's kind of come along. We accented this by taking that value right in here for all these sliders and pushing it down to this direction. So we hold that moya really strongly. So the ya is right in there. It's going to be kind of subtle though. I'm going to pull the pucker a little farther apart. Now for this D, he's got to get that mouth closed. And I think what I want to do is, actually I want to do really strong. And I'm going to pull that lip up, really put, get some attitude going in there. And the F we hear on fame, di fame, that's going to be really long, really exaggerated. because of the way he's performing this line, moya di fame. Really push that strong. And so you can't even hear it when you go through it frame by frame. This is where the tricky stuff happens, where you have to try and figure out where the release of the D is, where it gets into the F. Let's listen to this full speed a few times. So the D is right around in there. But again, it's not going to be that strong in terms of that. We will pull it a little wider, I think. Get some of that smirk going in there, just a touch more. Because we're going to start blending into the F under di fa me. And the fa me starts to kick out right around in there. And it's mostly breath. Those are interesting. Lots of breath before the actual sound of the ah comes in. You're really growling that low. It's fun to listen to. And the F actually starts right around in here, so we need to pull that lower lip. We're going to get rid of all the smirks. Actually, I think I'll probably kill both of those. We'll pull that up just a little bit, curl that puppy in, and I think I want to undo the wider and actually pucker him just a touch. So on the fa, it's going to be a little narrower because it goes fa me, so I want the A to be a little bit wider. So I think I'm going to pull that in just a little bit, and I want that snare in there. Actually, let me try making this mostly snare, because that gets a little more interesting curl into the lips than just pulling the lips straight up. Although, it can provide some interesting tricks when it comes to transitioning between these various shapes. Ooh, I like it. And it starts to release that F right around in here. So we're going to copy-paste that. To ease into this F, what I'm going to do is copy this. I think it was only in one frame, but I'm going to copy this one, push it over here, and that allows it to really settle into that D. And then for this one here, I think I'm going to go ahead and pull the jaw just a little bit further closed. Probably should actually pull this back one, because the ah starts to happen on this frame. All right, so he's opening up, uncurl. Actually, I might curl it out just a little bit. Open that jaw, do that. Oh, unsnare him just a little bit, so that upper lip isn't quite so, or it's not showing the teeth quite so much. Let's see how that looks. A little wider on the jaw. Really accent that as strongly as we can. Di fa me. I think we're almost going to wrap this clip up here, this initial pass. Okay, let's see how it looks. See how it sounds, rather. Listen to how that sounds. He's holding that ah really long before he gets into the M. Di fa me. So you got to hold that out as long as it needs. And that's another one of those points where blending into from the ah into the M is going to be kind of tricky. So what I'll probably do, that sounds like that's the starting point for the M right there on 95. Yeah. So we'll pull that. We'll undo the sneers because we've got to pull the lips shut. Well, actually, not totally close the jaw again. We're going to leave a little space in the jaw and then use the lips up and down to accomplish the compression on the M. A little bit of a pressure in there. And I think I'm going to, just a hair more puckered. Now we'll copy that right around here. So he starts to come out of the M into the A right about that point. And we haven't done anything with the tongue yet. You probably noticed that. I'll get into that a little bit later. I often like to get the main jaw and lip things working first, then come back in and do the tongue as a separate pass so I can really give it the attention it needs and get it in the right place where it needs to be for the different sounds. So we're only going to hold that right about there. Again, like we did before, we'll start to pull the jaw open, but we'll force the lips to stay closed. A little more pressure on that one. And I think I'll actually take this jaw open. Look at that. Do this with it. Take those upper and lower lips and do the same kind of thing. to exaggerate it anyway. That's the fun of experimentation and doing this stuff as you go along. So the may, I'm gonna do that, get the lips back where they belong, unpress them, pull that a little farther out, pull that smirk back in. Oh, not the smirk, the sneer. Actually, I think I want the smirk. A little bit of this. Oh, it's hard to tell. Sometimes the A's, those kind of generic wide A sounds can be the toughest ones to do. And it's getting into the, a little bit into the S on the beginning of this next sentence here. And he really doesn't hold that A very long. There's a lot of breath that happens right after that. Yeah, the A ends right about there. Let me relax the jaw a little bit. We'll maybe relax that upper lip a touch. And that's when he starts to breathe. We'll go ahead and leave it at this point here. And in the next segment, we'll start doing some fine-tuning and touch-ups on this first piece.